So there are a lot of places here on Earth. There are the thermal vents in the Pacific Ocean, and around those we have these little hydrothermal worms. Look pretty vicious. It looks like something out of an old B sci-fi movie. But actually it's only the size of a bacterium, so not so scary after all. In Mono Lake in California, an astrobiologist studied these little critters. They have a high phosphorus content, so she decided to see what would happen if you sort of like replaced their phosphorus with arsenic. So I know how that would affect me. So she did, and they just went along with their new little arsenic cells like nothing had happened, maybe a change of clothes. Down here is in Alaska is the cold research lab. This is a hangover from the oil drilling, and they actually resuscitated, revived, however you want, brought to non-freezing temperatures, if you will, these little microbes, and those microbes are embedded in a matrix that is 32,000 years old. These microbes, the last time they were moving, it was the Pleistocene era here on Earth. And they brought them into room temp, above freezing, and they just started moving around like they just had a 10-minute nap. And instead of a 32,000-year sleep. And then, I love this one, this is the Crystal Cave in Mexico. It is 300 feet below the surface. It's filled with these incredible crystals. I would love to go here. That can be as much as 25 feet long. They've been growing down there for about 100,000 to 200,000 years. They were discovered by a mining company that discovered the cave and drained it. They will eventually fill it back in again. It is 166 degrees with 99% humidity. And there are NASA astrobiologists down there too, but even in their full suited, they can only last for 20 minutes before they get too hydrated and they have to come out. They are desperately, feverishly trying to find microbes down there. And if they have time, they most probably will. But I just had to show this little guy. Actually, several images of this little guy because I love this little guy. This is a tardigrad. Now, he is the most extreme of the stromophiles, okay? The most extremophile microbe that we have. And he's about the size of a period at the end of a sentence, about 1 millimeter in size. So he looks he looks like he, you know, could do some damage, but no, he's very small. They love to live in lichen. They also live deep in the ocean. They live in the polar regions. They live in space. They will survive almost anything. Now, here he is in his lichen. If you live any place where there's lichen on the rocks, there'll be a whole bunch of those in there, unbeknownst to you. Now, I know that's only a face that a mother could love, but he looks so like puffy, like a puffball. I would love to be able to touch him. He is so extreme. They took him up to the space station and they subjected him to solar radiation in the near vacuum of space and didn't faze him a bit. So he is probably the most extreme of the extremophiles. However, a word of caution here. These are all carbon examples. Don't forget Carl Sagan coined the phrase Carbonchauvinism. There is nothing that says that life has to be carbon-based. It can be non-carbon-based life forms. We look for what we're familiar with and what we know. However, that doesn't mean that what's out there that's living is something totally alien to our experience. There is a NASA website that tells you all the missions, because you have to know all the, get a good idea of the major missions. It will tell you the past missions, the current missions, the planned missions. The JPL has a really incredibly good website. You'll be using that a lot for this event. You can find just about everything you want for this event on the JPL website. This one shows, talks about every single mission to all of the planets and the asteroids and the comets. Mars you're going to have a problem with because there have been so many missions to Mars. Keeping them straight might be a little difficult, but remember, you're interested in water and features that were formed by some kind of water, a moving water, a frozen water. And of course, we're up there right now. I mean, we have orbited Mars, we have landed on Mars, we've put robots all over, wandering all over Mars. You would think that we would be done with Mars, but no, because we're still looking for the holy grail of evidence of life on Mars. And every now and then, you know, curiosity will stop and do things like take a self-portrait. The rest of the time, he is busy looking at rocks, drilling holes into rocks, making it into a powder, bringing it into his little onboard lab to study the composition of that. But ultimately, his end goal is to reach Sharp Mountain, because we know sedimentary rock when we see it, and we're hoping to find some evidence of some kind of life that we're hoping started to thrive on Mars before before all the carbon dioxide got locked under the surface and there no longer anything was cycling.